This is Terms of Reference podcast number 158.
People learn primarily from their peers. And we read all sorts of research reports, et cetera, but we're really flooded with information. And we typically learn from our peers. And so implementing level people at aid agencies, of which I was one for a long time, your possibility set and what you do is heavily influenced by what your peers do. That makes these organizations inherently conservative at the staff level.
This is Terms of Reference. I'm your host, Stephen Laddick. I'd like to start today's episode with a quick informal poll. Ask yourself, as a social sector professional, do you regularly receive calls or emails from the people who you're trying to help where they ask, with great anticipation, about when the next version of your project or program will be released? While this regularly happens for other sectors, like you think of like mobile phones or automobiles or fashion, for the vast majority of us in the social sector, the answer to this question is emphatically no. The disconnect that this question exposes is the foundation that Dennis Whittle, who is my guest for today's 158th Terms of Reference podcast, stumbled upon a few years back, and which has now grown into a powerful collaborative effort to change how we help those in need. Dennis is the executive director of Feedback Labs, an organization that aims to change the norms in development, aid, and philanthropic policy to be more responsive to the people that those policies aim to help. Before Feedback Labs, Dennis was the co-founder of the groundbreaking Global Giving Platform. This is an important conversation because after we talk about the origins of Feedback Labs, we get into how they are helping to flip the generally top-down approach of the social sector to one that is truly responsive to local needs. The organizations that make up Feedback Labs believe we're now at a stage where you cannot not afford to get feedback from those you seek to help, and Dennis beautifully relates common issues faced by organizations and governments in being adaptive. So I invite you to sit back and enjoy this conversation with Dennis that looks to a future where feedback is not only the connected thing to do, but also the expected thing to do. I spoke with Dennis in Washington, D.C. But before we get started, here's a word from our sponsor.
The Terms of Reference podcast is sponsored by International Solutions Group, helping to improve the social impact of governments, UN agencies, NGOs, and companies for more than 10 years. Visit ISG online at www.theisg.com.
Hello, Dennis. Thank you so much for being on the Terms of Reference podcast today.
Thanks for having me, Stephen.
Dennis, I know from some of the discussion we had before we started recording that you are a true man of the world. You've been traveling around all over the place. Where do we find you today?
I'm in Washington, D.C., and under cloudy, overcast skies before the scorch of the summer hits us.
And we're recording this in late May of 2017. I am a DC veteran myself. I do not envy you the scorch of the summer, but I'm sitting in Bangkok where it's always a swamp. And
yeah, so. Exactly.
Maybe I don't have any sympathy. Dennis, you are the executive director of an organization called Feedback Labs. I've been wanting to get you on the show for some time now. I'm excited for this opportunity because feedback is, as you explained so eloquently across all of your communication, your blogs and your tweets and everything that goes out there, it's something that is still elusive to the social sector, to development and aid community. Let's start off, as we usually do, why don't you just tell us about what Feedback Labs is, what your kind of goal is?
Well, when I describe it, it seems kind of simple or maybe even simplistic, but actually, at least for many of us, it's a profound change of perspective, I think. And Feedback Labs is a network of about 300 organizations around the world. Some are domestic, some are international. There are policy, research, funding organizations involved, technology, companies and organizations involved, and frontline organizations also. And what they share in common is the desire to put three questions front and foremost in their work. And those three questions, again, seem really simple, but I think we've lost touch with them if we ever focused on them in the aid and philanthropy business. And they are, what do regular people want to make their lives better? Are we helping them get it? And if not, what should we do differently? So Feedback Labs members have realized that traditionally we've neglected just to ask the people themselves, what do you want? How can we help you get it? And if we're not doing a good job at it, how can we change to do a better job at it? A very different take than the old world that I grew up in at the World Bank in the 80s, which is experts are best placed to understand people's problems, to prescribe the medicine that will cure people's problems, and then even to monitor whether the medicine is effective or not. So this is putting the voice of the people back squarely into the center of the equation.
I'm lucky enough to have been around the aid and development business for about 15 years now myself. And I can remember even back, you know, when I was an intern at my very first NGO, this was, you know, this is something that was kind of built into the DNA. It's like, you know, we've got to go out and we would build our proposal before we first go to the community. We'd ask them, what do they need? And then we come back and we build our proposal. And then, you know, that's how we eventually win the funding to go do the work. Is that just a fallacy? I mean, does that just never happen? Or is that what you're saying has been lost along the way? Or why do these 300 organizations that are your members believe that we've that doesn't happen, even though it's kind of something that is lip service all the time?
Well, I don't know which organization you interned with, but the traditional way that big aid agencies and big aid programs have worked has been to hire high-level experts to go out and study countries and sectors and communities, and partly through interviewing people, but largely through other methods to make judgments about what these countries, communities, and sectors need to develop or grow faster. My own experience at USAID and at the World Bank and at the Asian Development Bank and at big foundations is that those design decisions, both diagnoses as well as prescriptions, were made by relatively small numbers of people sitting in offices in capital cities. Once those design decisions were made, they weren't checked or verified with the people involved, and they would be instantiated in projects that would last 5 years or so before they were evaluated. Mm-hmm. So you might have had an unusual experience. I think that's atypical rather than typical. Things are changing now, of course, which is why feedback labs came into existence. But I don't think that your experience typifies most people's experience in the field.
Okay, great. So take me through what, you know, as feedback labs, I'd like to kind of hear about the genesis, you know, like, did this happen over a napkin in a coffee shop, you know, between some agencies or some development players and said, you know, let's push this forward and go find funding for it? Or, you know, has this just sort of coalesced out of this common understanding somehow? Or was it really intentional? Somebody raised their hand and said, we're driving this forward. Like, how did this come into being?
You know, I think unlike other startups that I've been involved in, for example, Global Giving, where we knew exactly what we wanted to do, and we set out to relentlessly pursue that beginning 17 years ago, Feedback Labs emerged much more organically. And it's kind of funny how it came about. I was with the World Bank, as I said, for 15 years, doing big finance work all around the world. And then I was a co-founder of Global Giving, the first crowdfunding website, where I was CEO for 10 years. And when I stepped down as CEO from that, I was kind of tired. And I was kind of trying to loaf and take it easy. And I was doing a little teaching at Princeton and Chapel Hill, where I went to school. But one day, Nancy Birdsall, the president of the Center for Global Development, invites me to lunch. And she says, Dennis, what are you doing? And I said, well, and blah, blah, blah. I gave her a bunch of blah, blah, blah. And she said, why don't you come over and be a visiting fellow at the Center for Global Development? And I said, thank you, Nancy, but, you know, I wrote a lot of reports at the World Bank, and I don't do that anymore. Nobody ever read those reports. They were boring, turgid analyses of the economy and of different sectors, and that's just not my thing anymore. I'm an entrepreneur. And Nancy said, I still remember this. She said, that's okay. I remember when you left the World Bank to create Global Giving and how bizarre that concept was back then. That, incidentally, was 4 or 5 years before the word crowdfunding appeared on Google. Mm-hmm. And she said, come to Center for Global Development and just do something, think about something equally bizarre and orthogonal to what everybody's doing. And since Nancy has been very helpful to me over the years, even though I thought that was a dumb idea, I agreed, partly because I love the folks at Center for Global Development and was happy to spend time there. And I went over to the center, and I was just messing around, talking to my friends and drinking their free coffee, when one day I started messing around with my iPhone the way we all do. and I had it, and I was thinking about, I think that I had an iPhone 4, and I was kind of stroking it and looking at the features, and I was thinking to myself, the iPhone 5 is coming out soon. I can't wait. I'm going to get the iPhone 5 because it's got all these new features. It's going to be great. And I started thinking while I was stroking my iPhone, I don't think anybody, any villagers in Indonesia or the Philippines or anywhere that I worked in the World Bank ever looked at one of my projects and said, oh, Dennis has a new project coming out next year. I can't wait. I can't wait to get his project.
Sure, sure.
And that just kind of led me down a rabbit hole of thinking, you know, I didn't spend a lot of time with the villagers and the farmers that I was supposed to be helping. And I did not iterate my products and projects. And I hope they made a difference in people's lives, but really they weren't like an iPhone. They were kind of more like the Apple Newton. Great in concept, but not very good in execution. And so I wrote a paper about feedback loops or the lack of feedback loops in aid. And it was kind of a personal paper. It was my own story of 14 or 15 years in the field at the World Bank, really not only not listening to people actively, but avoiding listening to people, to be honest. Because hearing what people wanted or what they thought of my projects could only have negative consequences for me as a World Bank project person. It would derail my project, slow it down, make it more expensive. They might say they didn't like it, and I would look bad. So I actually had a disincentive to listen to people. And Lant Pritchett, I don't know if you've had Lant on the show, but Lant wrote a great paper some years ago called It Pays to Be Ignorant. And the basic idea is that everybody expects your project to be successful, so that's the kind of baseline. But if word gets out that your project is unsuccessful at a place like the World Bank, you'll be punished. So there's kind of a conspiracy of incentives to not solicit or publicize real feedback from people. I wrote this paper and didn't think much about it, but I got contacted by a lot of organizations in Washington and around the world that said, hey, we're already starting to work on this. You gave it a name called feedback loops, but it's exactly what we've been working on from various angles, sometimes technology, sometimes implementation, sometimes funding, et cetera. Can we get together and have lunch? So Feedback Labs began as a series of weekly lunches at the Open Gov Hub here in Washington, D.C., where a bunch of these organizations are. Sure, and we just started talking. Then, unexpectedly, we got approached by some foundations, led by the Rita Allen Foundation, Elizabeth Christofferson and Rita Allen Foundation, and then the Hewlett Foundation, led by Faye Twersky and Ruth Levine and Lindsay Louie. And they said, you know, we have the same problem in philanthropy. Can we talk to you? The third leg of the stool was when the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy said, hey, government, U.S. government is just as bad at not listening. Can you come and talk to us about this? So in December 2013, Hewlett Foundation, White House, and I got together and put on a conference about this, which was extremely well attended at the White House. And shortly after that, we decided to launch Feedback Labs as a formal entity.
That's a fantastic story. I love that. Thank you so much for the detail on that. Now we're sitting here, it's 2017. You're well into, I'm going to say, the fourth, if not fifth year, maybe a little even more, of not only thinking about this, but tangibly sort of working on it. Kind of what's your go-to story of what's come out of it? Not only the membership base, obviously, that you have, and clearly a conversation that's taking root, but are you starting to see changes from a government level or from an agency level that you can kind of point to?
I think a few things I would point to. One is when we started this work, there was kind of a reaction from the system. And by the system, I mean people and organizations doing things the traditional way. Like, what is this? This is ridiculous. What are you talking about? People don't really know what they want or need or how to make their lives better. And that reaction came about because the existing system is built on more of a top-down mentality and framework. As we've expanded around the world, I think we've kind of gotten past that initial reaction. And that's significant. We've both done research and synthesized research and held a lot of conversations about why listening to people is not only the right thing to do morally and ethically, but in many situations, it's demonstrably the smart thing to do. Mm-hmm. And in a variety of projects, and the research is at early stages, but there are enough to point to. When feedback is well implemented, you can see substantial improvements in impact. You can see 25% reductions in infant and child mortality, which is astonishing. You can see similar, you know, 1/4 to 1/3 increases in survival rates at hospital operating, post-operating rooms. You can see, you know, 15-point gains in educational attainment and testing scores. So we spent a lot of our first couple years just looking at the research and bringing researchers and others together to look at the evidence. So I think we've kind of gotten past this stage of why would we listen to people?
Sure.
And now we've gotten to the next stage of how do we do it well and how do we do it effectively and how do we do it practically? So we talk about feedback as the right thing to do, the smart thing to do, and the feasible thing to do. And I think now we're at the stage of people talking about feasibility. They're like, yeah, we know it's obvious. You know, it's obvious we need to do it. Now, how do we do it effectively and efficiently?
And does someone come to Feedback Labs as a consulting service, or do they join as a member and that's how they pull intellectual property out of it? Or you know, what's the interaction with the community? Are you putting IP on the street that is kind of open source that anybody can use?
We ourselves at the labs don't do a lot of direct service or put together a lot of IP. We do have a few toolkits and playbooks and things like that. But we see our role more as catalyzing collaboration among our members to get the tools out there and get the IP out there. So our members will be the ones generally to provide advisory services, consulting, SMS and voice response tools, et cetera. And we'd see ourselves as trying to be a catalyzer of collaboration among them and a connection between them and the people that will use their services. So every 2 weeks, we have something called a lab storm, where somebody will come in and present either a problem that they need to be solved or a solution that they think might be able to address someone's feedback-related problem. And we have the community come in from around the world online and then in person and talk about both solutions and problems. So we're kind of a matchmaker, convener, a lab in the sense that a lot of times our members will come together to invent new things that they couldn't invent themselves.
The way that you tell the story of the genesis and how it's all come together and then sort of the recognition of the plot problem by the community, it's kind of a dream story, right? I mean, the funding kind of came to you, the community coalesced around the idea. Beyond the initial acceptance of people sort of scratching their heads and saying, you know, is this even something to think about? What are the barriers that you come up against as a, maybe as a community or in these lab storms that you find most often with organizations who are having trouble, you know, closing these feedback loops with citizens? Is there a playlist that you kind of are starting to hear over and over again, or is every problem truly unique?
I think you see patterns emerge that are common, and I'll mention a few aspects. First is that organizations that are out there in the field asking for feedback from people. In general, they report that people just aren't used to having feedback solicited from them. They don't feel a sense of agency. They don't believe that what they say will make any difference. Mm-hmm. Often, they have been subjected to many questionnaires and research projects, and they almost never even hear the results of those projects. So one of our members of our network says, you know, for God's sake, would everyone please avoid being an asshole? I remember when he said this, I think this is Lei Vu. I said, you know, what did you say? He said, we're all just a bunch of assholes. He said, we just go out and ask 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 questions. And people are sick of it. And in fact, we're imposing a cost on them. So the first step is to overcome the sense that people feel of either being suspicious if they've never been asked a question, or sometimes hostile because they've been asked so many questions and it's never helped them. So that's a big issue, is how to convince people that their voice will matter. And so a lot of our members have different techniques for doing that. Just sometimes reporting back to people on what they said, it feels almost miraculous to them. It provides information to them and is a sign of respect that no one's ever afforded them before. So that's at the beginning of the process of collecting feedback. That's one common theme. Then all the way at the other end, aid agencies, philanthropies, and governments don't have decision-making processes that are adaptive. They're not used to making changes in either what they do or how they do it very frequently. They're kind of operating in the old punch card mode of computers. Design something, you stick it in the compiler, and you come back a long time later to see how it turned out. And so they don't have ways where they can sit down regularly inside agencies and say, what did we hear this week or this month? And then given what we heard, how should we change what we're doing?
Mm-hmm.
And what does it take to make those changes? So that's increasingly being seen. And I'm spending a lot of my time with big agencies, just helping them think, how would you do that? Because that's so alien to the way that you operated in the past. In the past, you've had this design up front. Then you manage the narrative of the outcome very, very carefully all the way through the evaluation process so you don't get punished politically or bureaucratically.
That was a very nice way to put that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Those are just two common aspects that we see, a sense of agency at the beginning of the process and then actually being able to close the feedback loop at the funding level by making sure that you do something differently, that you respond.
I don't know how much detail you're able to go into when you're speaking with funding agencies. This is something that we've heard fairly consistently across the show, over the past couple of years, where one of the things that especially small organizations, but we've had a fairly good number of large organizations here as well. One of the roadblocks that they find themselves confronting all the time is it's the contracting process, it's the procurement process, or it's just the inflexibility of moving within that space, right? Once you receive that 5-year agreement or once you've entered into that contract, then your room for movement is relatively limited. Even though the people we've had on the show say, there is light there. My question really is, are you starting to hear that from agencies that they're coming up with different vehicles or their management systems are changing, or I'll leave it to you.
Yeah, I think that's a perfect example that illustrates what we try to do and hopefully are having some effect. So working with the USAID Global Development Lab, we have created something called the Practical Adaptation Network. And this is a network where we bring together people that are working on similar topics across agencies. Some of those might be the HR people in charge of recruiting and retaining and providing incentives for people. One of the groups is a procurement group. So it brings together procurement people from across major agencies. And together, they're trying to look at ways they can make the procurement process more flexible and adaptive. And then also make staff aware of the flexibility that already exists. And there's a strange dynamic in big agencies where sometimes, not always, but sometimes people at the very top of functions such as procurement have actually built in new flexibility, but nobody believes them. So staff just keep doing the same thing over and over again. But in any case, Feedback Labs helps bring together these procurement folks to talk about how they can raise awareness as well as support each other in making procurement processes more flexible.
How does someone go about socializing that? I smiled, obviously you can't see me, but I smiled on the other end of the phone when you say, here's an agency that, they've actually built this process in, and yet here's this ecosystem that's, let's not call that, here's this structure underneath them that knows that it's on there, that knows that policy's been created or know that that's available, but, the structure doesn't allow them to even utilize it. Do you have any sense about how you socialize that and sort of, is it just time? Is it strong leadership? Is it somebody, just sticking their neck out and taking a risk or?
It's Hewlett Foundation just released a really interesting report pointing out something that, if you think about it, we all know, which is that people learn primarily from their peers. We read all sorts of research reports, et cetera, but we're really flooded with information, and we typically learn from our peers. And so implementing level people at aid agencies, of which I was one for a long time, your possibility set and what you do is heavily influenced by what your peers do. Mm-hmm. And that makes these organizations inherently conservative at the staff level. So I remember one day back in the 1990s when I actually decided to read the procurement handbook at the World Bank. And I said to myself, wow, there's a lot more I could do than what I've been doing.
Holy smokes, I had those options. I didn't even know it.
Exactly. But I went to see some of my friends and they're like, no, 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 you can't do that. And I was like, but show me where it says I can't do that. And they couldn't point out where it was prohibited, but they said, no, 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 you can't do it. So I remember my own terror in the 90s of deciding to do some of these things. And I got away with it. It was miraculous, but it was terrifying. A lot of the answer to your question is bringing together peer groups, whether at the top, whether the senior people who need to support each other in making changes that might be scary to them, or at the staff implementing level, and just getting them to talk about it and give examples of what each other is doing. And that's how you bring about change. But, you know, that Hewlett study is, it's great because it confirms, like, duh, of course that's the way we operate. But we don't build on that insight often when we're trying to create change within organizations.
What you're triggering me right now is, you know, so you put together the Lab Storms, you said, on a biweekly basis, I think. And have there now been, I guess, you know, over the course of the last 4 years, aha moments of organizations coming back to those events and saying, you know what, you know, we came here, we solicited feedback and we went and tried it and holy smokes, it worked and everybody else should try this? Or, you know, are you starting to see some real just sort of definitive solutions come out of those, like that you know, you're kind of able to pin up on the board and say, hey, look, this works in this situation, this works in this situation?
Yeah, I wouldn't say definitive solutions, but there are many aha moments that come out of these things when people see how others do things. A lot of these are related to data, since so many of our members, you know, have data platforms. We all have data platforms, bigger or smaller. And we're starting to see huge efficiency gains just in the way that people manage their data and make it interoperable. Mm-hmm. And we could have a whole other show about the value of interoperable data in terms of becoming more effective and more efficient. So that's one. Another is the idea that the cost of asking people what they think has plunged so far below what we used to think it was, that it radically changes the presumption around asking people what they think. And let me just tell you this one story that came out of an early set of Lab Storms. There was a Canadian and Ghanaian small startup called Voto Mobile that had figured out how to call up people in countries around the world on their cell phones and ask them in a local language questions. And we got this company together with a Center for Global Development and the World Bank to see if they could mimic household surveys faster and cheaper. And so, as many of your listeners know, household surveys are these almost census-like instruments that have been the foundation of our understanding of people's lives over the past, you know, 50 years. And they involve going door to door and administering these long paper-based surveys. They cost millions of dollars. They take years to compile sometimes and are frequently available to us, you know, 3 or 4 years after they were administered. And so if you're doing projects at a place like the World Bank, you rely on these outdated household surveys that often don't even ask the questions that you really want to know about and are frequently not very disaggregated in terms of demographics. So Voto Mobile, working together with Center for Global Development, which was doing the statistical rigor part, and the World Bank, which has an interest in knowing this stuff, were able to go out to 4 of the poorest countries in the world: Afghanistan, Haiti, I think it was Zimbabwe, and one other, maybe Zambia, and were able to do a mini survey 100 times cheaper and 10 times faster.
I was waiting for the numbers because, I mean, it had to be fractions of pennies on the dollar.
It was, two orders of magnitude cheaper, 100 times cheaper and 10 times faster. And I think the whole thing costs $50,000 or $60,000. And the statistical accuracy wasn't quite at the same level as household surveys, but it was kind of a Gallup poll level. So it's very respectable. And this is kind of a game changer, because what this means is that if you're doing projects, you no longer have the excuse of not being able to ask people what they care about to make their lives better. It's now possible to go out and ask them. And that's a profound change in the mental model of what it takes to do a project. And it's so profound that people still don't have their brains around it.
If I can just riff on that for a second, because I'm lucky enough to be familiar with Voda Mobile. We've been lucky to work with them in some of the projects that I've worked on. But I still find myself consistently coming up against, and that's not even the right term, but experiencing individuals who are reluctant to trust in a system like what Voda Mobile's built, simply because they're of the, and I hate to say this, but because they're of the old guard, right? The pencil and paper, or even, the Excel spreadsheets is what they're used to using. And they're not sure that it'll work. Not only will it not work, but it won't be effective, or it won't be as accurate. And I'm wondering, have you heard this in your community as well, where there's just almost a mini digital divide between maybe some of the old guard of the social sector and this sort of new burgeoning digital world coming up? Is that starting to be broken down within Feedback Labs as well?
Well, we're working on it, but as I said, I think we're at the early stages. And a lot of the old guard has two reactions, and I'm kind of the old guard now, so I...
Well, you're certainly a proponent, though. Yeah, but...
My first reaction is, oh, we've been doing that for a long time. Participatory development is not new. So there's some defensiveness around that, and that's fair enough. Sometimes the younger generation claims to have invented, the wheel, and the older guard comes back and says, we invented the wheel a long time ago. When the truth of the matter is that, there's a dramatically new wheel with an axle and bearings that are so much better that it's almost a new tool. But there's that reaction. We already invented the wheel. And then there is an assumption that it's not very rigorous. And people start asking a lot about statistical rigor and bias, et cetera, et cetera. So one of the things that we try to do at Feedback Labs is bring these two groups together. And that Voda Mobile experiment with CGD and World Bank was an example of that. How do you get people who have been thinking about it from the old guard, see the young guard coming, and help them make it rigorous? And the CGD folks, Ben Leo and others there, were able to make this experiment statistically very rigorous. And then have people from the World Bank there to evangelize it inside the World Bank. But even when you do that, it doesn't change things overnight. Change, the diffusion of innovation is a slow process, which you can speed up, but you can't make instantaneous.
Mm. So, you're the helm of this organization, this network, this movement, so to speak. You've been the head of certainly catalytic innovation before at Global Giving. What do the next 2, 3, 4 years look like for where Feedback Labs goes? Do you have a roadmap that you're following, or are you simply nurturing this network and making sure that it's well-supported and continues to mature and capturing the ahas as they come out?
Well, I'd say that there are maybe 3 vectors of our trajectory that I'm thinking about. One is kind of the intellectual, theoretical research vector. And a lot of what we're doing builds on, we stand on the shoulders of my own heroes here. My first professor at graduate school was Angus Deaton, 33 years ago or 34 years ago. People like Jeff Hammer and Lamp Pritchett and Bill Easterly. I know you had Chris Blattman on your show recently. Michael Wilcock. I'm missing many others. Even Albert Hirschman. I'm only talking about the ones who are alive. But all of them, Eleanor Ostrom, they've all written things and done work that lays the foundation for this. And so part of what I want to do is continue to develop the theory and research and empirical side of this. It's very important from a theory and framework point of view.
Mm-hmm.
So that's number one. In the foundation sector, incidentally, leaders like Faye Twersky and Ruth Levine and Elizabeth Christofferson, these people are truly pushing. Larry Kramer, Xavier de Briggs-Souza, Hillary Pennington, these people are, Kathy Rich, these people are pushing the new frontiers of theory and practice in philanthropy. And so I want to continue to work with them to help develop and promote what they've, laid the groundwork for. The second vector is sectoral. And when I started this, I come from the aid sector. So I've conceived this primarily as aid related. But as I mentioned, foundations came and said, no, we have the same problem. Then more recently, government agencies have come and said, hey, no, our problem is just as bad. We don't know how to listen to people either. So we want to be in on this. And that's happened both at the national level, I mentioned the White House, but also many cities in the United States have tremendous city administrations, and people really committed to listening to their citizens. And a lot of them attend our events. And now even internationally. And in November, I was helping co-host a meeting with the Global Delivery Initiative and the government of China, in Chongqing, with all the Southeast Asian countries present. And they're thinking about things like, how can we engage citizens better in our processes? So that's the second vector, which is expanding it to all these different sectors. And then the third vector is kind of the thinking about the trajectory of a movement or of a new way of thinking about things. We started out talking about feedback as the right thing to do, morally and ethically, and that appeals to social justice-oriented people. And then feedback as the smart thing to do. It has a demonstrable impact. It makes projects more effective and efficient. And that appeals to a different group of people. Last year, we focused on feedback as the feasible thing to do. Mm. These are the people that are already convinced. It's like, obvious, just tell us how to do it. This year, we're going to talk about feedback as the connected thing to do. And our feedback summits, which we have every year, this upcoming one is in November, if any of your listeners are interested, it'll be focused on feedback as the connected thing to do. And you can't do silos of feedback. You need to connect with others to get and act on good feedback. That'll be the fourth. And then next year, or in the coming years, we'll be focusing on feedback as the expected thing to do. And this gets back to the peer-to-peer thing. It's like, when we get to the point where your peers are doing it, then you will do it as well. Everyone will do it.
Sure, it's the norm at that point.
Tipping point. It's the norm. So I wish we could say the norm will tip next year. I don't know when it will tip, but that's, of course, the long-term goal, feedback as the expected thing to do.
I have two questions that I ask everybody in this innovation series here on the podcast. And the first one is, who do you pay attention to? Obviously, you are in a privileged position. You're at the center, one of the main actors within this giant organization, 300 organizations, you said, within it. But are there specific streams of information? I mean, it could be a Twitter feed, or it could be a magazine, or it could be The Economist, who knows, that you listen to or that you pay attention to that you think, you know, they get it. And this is something that you think our listeners should perhaps pick up and pay attention to?
I'll just tell you that my own feed, I guess, my people at the top of my feed, and they come in various ways. Econ Talk, the podcast Econ Talk. Mm-hmm. I always tell the young people that work for me, if you want to get a master's or better in economics, you don't need to go to school. Just listen to Econ Talk every week. That's Russ Roberts, Hoover, and he interviews everybody on all sorts of topics, and it's fantastic. And Russ himself is more of a libertarian conservative Chicago school guy, but he's very open-minded, and it's one of the most intelligent podcasts, probably number two to Aidpreneur.
Thank you.
Close second. Others, Bill Easterly has been a huge influence on me over time. Bill's books primarily. We worked together at the World Bank, and Bill was one of the first people to say that the emperor has no clothes. And he had the guts to say that, and he has developed that through a series of books over time that have deepened the analysis of the need for sort of bottom-up organic emergent development. So Bill's number two. Lant Pritchett, his stuff is uniformly great. I highly recommend reading his stuff, whether it comes out of Harvard or the Center for Global Development. And that leads me to the Center for Global Development. For your listeners who are in Washington or at least watch the working papers that come out from CGD, CGD has the greatest collection, I think, of thinkers on this topic. Jeff Hammer at Princeton, at the Woodrow Wilson School, just wrote a great piece on the use and abuse of randomized controlled trials, but he's also fantastic. Michael Wolcock, who's at the Development Research Group at the World Bank and also at Harvard, a sociologist, has had a huge effect on the way I think about evidence, how to make sense of the world, and how to act on that. Keith Hansen at the World Bank, many others. You had Chris Blattman on. Chris is great, great guy. So those are some of the folks on my list. I read extremely widely, so it's hard. I know I'm missing some folks.
Now, that is one of the most extensive lists that I've heard so far. Thank you so much for that. The last question I have is an opportunity for you to essentially give a shout out to either an organization, individual, or some process or technology that you just think it's one of the next best things, or it hasn't seen the light of day the way that it needs to. Is there something out there that maybe isn't necessarily even related to feedback labs that's helping people out there that you're like, this needs to get more recognition?
Well, I would cite the Fund for Shared Insight, which is a coalition of large foundations led by Hewlett and Ford, and it includes Packard and Rockefeller and LiquidNet, and I'm going to miss a lot of them, Rita Allen Foundation, Irvine Foundation, Barr. This is a very unusual situation where senior leaders at foundations have started to get together and not just pool money to support things like feedback loops, but they're determined themselves to lead the change in their sector. And these are organizations that invest billions and billions and billions of dollars every year. And they've created sort of a social capital among themselves, which is quite extraordinary. And it's a great example. I think people talk about collective impact all the time or whatever, write papers about it. But this is a great example of a bunch of funders who've gotten together and said, we are going to put our hearts and soul and heads into this as well as our money into this. And it's something that's not well known. It's only started a couple of years ago, but has already been instrumental in spreading this idea around the world, this idea of feedback loops, of listening to the people that we seek to serve.
Dennis, this has been a absolutely fantastic conversation. I thank you so much for your insights, and I hope it's not the last time we talk.
Thank you very much. Thanks for doing your podcast, and I look forward to the next time.
Hey guys, if you have found this conversation with Dennis valuable, we'd really like to get your feedback. So can you take a few seconds and give us a rating on iTunes or Stitcher or whatever it is that you happen to be listening to this podcast on? And, you know, if you did like it, spread it out to the world, put it on Facebook or share it on Twitter for us. And you could always have the option of, you know, sending us an email or giving us a comment on the blog. Thanks.
You've been listening to the Terms of Reference podcast from aidpreneur.com. Subscribe to us on iTunes.